Good morning, Victory, and happy Mother's Day. We're so excited for you to be tuned in this morning. We're just going to worship the Lord and just invite the presence of God into this place and pray that He enter your homes. We're so glad that you tuned in with us. So as we just come before the Lord, let's just bow our hearts in prayer. Father God, we thank you for this day. For today is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. God, we turn our attention to you. Lord, we look to you this morning, and we know, God, that when we do that, things change, God. In prayer and worship, things can change. So, God, we turn to you this morning, and we know that mighty and marvelous things can happen, Lord. Thank you for being present with us. Thank you for mothers. Thank you for what you're going to do this morning. In Jesus' mighty name.
This world I will lay them at your feet, surrender every anxious thought for perfect peace, perfect peace.
Yes, I will.
All the loved ones I hold dear, all my hopes and dreams and all my fears, I will choose to trust your name with everything, with everything. I will look up, for there is none above you. I will bow down to tell you that I need. Jesus, Lord of all, Jesus, Lord of all, yeah. I will take you at your word. Taken hold of me, all my life is in your hands. You are my strength, you are my strength. I will look up, for there is none above you. I will bow down to tell you that I need you, Jesus. Savior, all my life,
just want you to receive that this morning. This song is speaking a blessing over your household to distinguish you right now, a blessing that covers you, that you can abide under the shadow of the Most High God. You see, this song came out just a few weeks or a week before this coronavirus hit, and I believe it was a prophetic timing that God released this song so that he could speak over his people, so that he could speak it over his church, his beloved bride, his children, saying, while deep darkness covers the earth, a great light can rise upon my people. I want to bless you. I want to keep you. I want you to know that my face is shining over you. So this morning as we sing this, we just ask that you would open your heart and that you would hear Father God speaking his blessing over you. praise you, Jesus. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. We thank you, Father. There's nothing like your blessing, Father. There's nothing like the Father's blessing. There's nothing like the Father's blessing. And we receive it by saying our amen. See, the Bible says that all the promises of God are yes and amen to the glory of God. You see, the promises in God are yes. His blessing is a yes over your life, but we have to add our amen, our agreement. That's why we sing the amen. That's why we say the amen during a message. When we add our agreement, we are applying the promise. We are applying the blessing. And I want to tell you, this blessing can come into your household and you cannot receive it by not adding your amen. And that's why we sing it. So I just want to tell you that the Father wants to bless you. His mercies are new every morning. And the way we catch those blessings, those new mercies, is by coming into agreement with it and adding our amen. So this morning, as you've heard the blessing of God over your life, as you've believed that He has a heart for you, that He loves you, believe it and speak amen. And we believe that that will come into your household. God bless you this morning.
Amen. It's so good to come into God's presence and know that you don't have to be in a sanctuary for the presence of God to begin to manifest in your life. It can be right there in the car if you're driving or in your living room. And so greetings from Victory Church. And again, we miss you guys. We're looking forward to the day we can come back together. But in the meantime, we just love you tuning in to these live stream services. And today, as you know, is Mother's Day, so we have Supermom with us on the stage today. She has such incredible insights, and I know you're going to be blessed by what she has to say today. You know, just now when we were in worship, I just got a burden for not just all mothers, but one mother in particular, and that's the mother of Ahmaud Arbery, who was just now discovered, was gunned down and covered up, and it's brought national attention. And we know that this occurrence is not just any other murder, but it shows the undercurrent of a hatred and a racism that still is in our society. And I think we go quite a while in between incidents like this, and in a sense, we kind of have it on the back burner of our mind, the idea of hatred and racism. You know, things are, you know, they're getting better, but this shows, and it just proves that, sadly, it's our reality that hatred and racism still exist in our country, and we still have a battle in a war to be won. And so I thought it might be appropriate that before we go any farther, especially before we get into the message, I want to pray for all the moms. But would you join me, and Pippa, will you join me in praying for Ahmaud's mother right now? As she can't get away from the memory of what happened because of the media. And so I just feel we can use her as a representation of praying for all the moms. Some moms are hurting today. I know Pippa has mixed feelings during Mother's Day because she's lost her mom years ago. And so in the middle of the celebration, there's still some needs of healing. So will you just join me in prayer? Father, we thank you for this day and what it represents. It represents celebrating mothers, those who we esteem and honor the highest level in our lives. None of us would be here if it wasn't for our moms. And in the midst of the celebration, though, Father, our hearts, I believe, as a nation are heavy for one particular mother, and that's Ahmaud's mother, who is grieving the loss of her son and having to be in the middle of this national tragedy. So, Lord, I just lift her up to you together as a body of believers. And we pronounce your blessings over her in Jesus' name. May she be a representation of all moms that are hurting today, all moms, Lord God, that have maybe lost a son or a daughter. God, I pray that on this Mother's Day, you'll release a healing power into her life and all hurting moms' lives, including those sons and daughters that have lost their mothers. Lord, right now, I'm just praying for an anointing to come in and heal the brokenhearted. And God, not only heal the hearts of moms and sons and daughters, but God, we repent. We stand in the gap for this nation. We repent for hatred. We repent for injustice. We repent for racism. We repent for the lies and the cover-up and the pretending like everything's okay. We repent as church leaders, thinking somehow this is going to go away by itself. We repent, God. We repent as a church for being silent. We repent for not being proactive. We repent for not taking this thing on and taking it by the horns of the bull and saying racism cannot exist in our churches, cannot exist in our communities, cannot and will not exist in our nation. And we will continue to fight for righteousness. We will continue to fight for justice. We will continue to fight for God's will and His kingdom to come right here in our community. God, start today, a Mother's Day, to break through as a revival hit our land and to rid it of hatred and injustice. May revival come and replace racism, God. So, Father, we thank you for your promise to come and heal our land and heal the mothers that are hurting, especially Ahmad's mother right now, Father. So we just thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, there's power in prayer as we couple our faith and in agreement with churches all over the nation and in the world. We just believe there's a breakthrough in that a racist spirit that still is in our land. So anyway, happy Mother's Day, baby. You looking good, too. You looking really good.
Today, I especially want to say a happy, happy Mother's Day to all our incredible moms at Victory. I wish today I could hug you and say happy Mother's Day in person. Oh, wait, I can do that. So I want all the moms to drive through today the church parking lot. Husbands, put your wife in the car and put your mom in the car and then drive through the church. It is twofold to come today. Maybe threefold. The first one is you get to see the parking lot in person. We're so excited about what God has done there. Secondly, we get to honor and celebrate all you incredible moms. You guys are such a blessing. We love you. We don't want you missing out on your rose today. So make sure you come through so that we can give you that rose. And then thirdly, I get to see you. I'd love to see all the moms at Victory today. And I especially want to see those cute little kids that I have missed so incredibly much. And so make sure you come by so that I can high five you and give you a wave and give you an air hug. And we're just so excited to celebrate you today. And we want you to be part of that with us. So don't miss out on driving through between 1 and 2 after the service. Get in the car, get your food order ready, and you can pick that up while you're out today, and then enjoy a special Mother's Day. We're so glad that you're with us. I especially want to extend just an appreciation to everybody that continues to give. You know, God has been so faithful through this. This has been a different season for every church and every person in our nation and in our country, but you guys have been so rock solid and faithful in your continued support of Victory. We have been doing very well as a church through this process financially, and it's to you guys we owe a special thank you to. Thank you for continuing to give. Thank you for continuing to honor God with your resources. And through this time, we know that as you continue to give into His kingdom, He will continue to pour a blessing on your life where you need it, and is so faithful to do that. So we just appreciate you giving now, taking that time to give online. There should be a link coming up on the screen. You can text your giving. That number should be coming up on the screen at 770-285-5055. And you can give by just texting the word give to that number. And again, we thank you. We thank you for that opportunity as you give. And one other announcement, this is graduation month. So many people are graduating this month. They're not getting that opportunity to graduate. But we want to honor our graduates here at Victory Church. We do this every year. And so if you're a senior and you're graduating, maybe you're a college student and you're graduating, make sure you go to the website. There's a link there that we need you to fill out. Fill out the form. Let us know that you're graduating because we want to celebrate you at the end of the month. And so make sure you go ahead and do that. While you're doing all those, let me go ahead and pray for you as we get ready to receive the word today. God, we just thank you for this opportunity to be in your presence. God, I thank you for every mom, every person that's out there watching today. I thank you that you're pouring a blessing on their lives. God, everybody that continues to give into your kingdom, even through difficult times, God, when we take that step and we give back into your kingdom, you're so faithful to meet our needs. God, we just thank you for this opportunity as we give of our resources that you pour a blessing on every person today. God, that the people of Victory Church will not lack because of your faithfulness in their lives. We thank you for meeting their needs. We thank you for meeting their emotional needs, their spiritual needs, God, and their financial needs. God, we thank you for this opportunity of being able to worship you, of being able to give, and then being able to hear the word today. God, we thank you for all that you're doing in our lives. May you open our hearts and our ears to hear your word today. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Hey, I want to throw in another announcement. We're doing something special on Thursday night. We've been having amazing times of prayer. Thursday night at 7 p.m. It's live streamed here on Facebook. This Thursday, though, God put on my heart and gave me a picture of a circle of prayer around the building. So what we're asking you to do is, even though you can't come into the building and meet in person, we're asking you to drive onto the parking lot Thursday at 7 o'clock. Have your smartphone out so you can watch the Facebook Live prayer meeting. But I want to see a whole circle around the building. And we're going to pray over the building. We're going to pray over the ministry. I really believe this is going to be a crucial prayer night, an hour of prayer, preparing the church for what God wants to do as we strategize into coming back as a church after the COVID-19. And so just come into your car. Just follow someone's lead. You're going to stop. You can get out of your car. You can air high five people around you. Then afterwards, I'll come out. And as you leave, I'll be waving to you, praying blessings over you. So don't miss out. Thursday, 7 o'clock p.m., come and circle the building. Park your cars in a circle, and we're going to have a time of powerful prayer. Amen. I'm excited about that. So we have to do the prayer in here because of the equipment. But you're going to be out there. We're going to be in agreement, and it's going to be great. All right? Okay. So happy Mother's Day again. You know, there's on Mother's Day, it's all about moms. It's all about, you know, congratulating them and praising them and celebrating them. And it's a time of great happiness, you know, because of the things that we do on Mother's Day. We say, you're so beautiful, Mom, and thank you so much for what you do. And I began to think about it, that a mother is very happy, and there's a lot of happiness in a family on Mother's Day because of those three things. Moms are thanked profusely. Moms are praised for all that they've done and all they've put up with, and there's a lot of celebration. And as I was pondering that, I felt the Lord say, those are the same things that cause happiness in a marriage, happiness in a life, happiness in a home. So we're going to go a step beyond Happy Mother's Day, and we're going to talk about how to have happiness in the home. And we're going to use this old scale as an illustration, so that you can walk away with a picture of how you can have happiness instead of unhappiness in your home. So we're going to label the sides here. And the goal, which one you got there? The goal is to, let's put happy on my side because, okay, maybe not. That's very unhappy how I did that. I thought you were going to have to take those apart. All right. So the goal is to get the scale to tip towards happiness. When it's tipped towards happiness, then we're happy. So what is it? We know these old scales. When you put weights on one side or the other, it tilts it up or it tilts it down. So the goal is to find out what can we do to put on this side of the scale so it tips to happiness, or what is it that we are doing or putting into our families or into our lives that's causing it to tip towards unhappiness. I'm just telling you right now, this practical word that you're going to get today and over the next 30 minutes or so can literally turn things around, can literally take you from one happy Mother's Day to happiness in your marriage and in your home. So let's start off with, what is it that we're doing? And especially during this COVID-19 sheltered in, I think what happened is it's been putting some pressure on marriages and some pressures on family. Parents aren't used to their kids being home like all the time and like homeschooling them. Some couples aren't used to being together. The guy either travels or the woman travels. And so we've gotten reports and we've gotten calls and we've done a lot of praying for people who, because of the sheltered in, they're finding out how unhappy things really are. And so this is a timely message, and so we just want to say, let's look at what's causing unhappiness and what can we do to cause happiness. So let's start off with, sadly, the unhappy. What are people doing, or what do we do to put weights on this side and cause unhappiness? You want to kick it off?
Sure. I think a lot of times what happens in the home is we begin to, especially when you've been around for so long and you've been in each other's company for so long, that we've noticed there's a lot of complaining that takes place. There's a lot of criticism that takes place. And we begin to be able to see every single little thing and nitpick everything that happens within the home. And so we begin to make a comment about that because now we're seeing it on a regular basis. And so we criticize what's taking place. And so we nitpick those little things and point out every little mistake, point out every little thing that they may be doing that maybe on a regular basis doesn't exactly happen, but now we're seeing it a lot more. And so we begin to criticize that on what maybe your spouse is doing and or your children are doing. And instead of being positive about it, we begin to criticize them and we point out the mistakes. We point out what they're doing. And I'm not saying we you know, it's not a good idea to do that. There's a way to be able to bring different corrections or pointing out things that they're doing. But we're talking about just the little mistakes, the basic things that happen on a regular basis, and pointing those out in the home.
Yes.
And that takes away the happiness.
Yeah, so all these illustrations, none of them have to do anything with the hidden home, okay? Because, you know, we don't do any of this, all right? If you believe that, I've got some real estate for sale in swampland in Florida. But anyway, so we're talking about things being said like, when are you ever going to start taking out the garbage without me asking you to? I mean, do you really need to ask that question? Or kids, when are you ever going to clean your rooms? You don't have any? Is it just me? Or we say things like, can we ever get a meal on time in the hidden home? I'm hungry. When are we going to eat? These are things that when are said and communicated, they're critical and criticized, and it really sucks the happiness right out of a marriage. And so what Pippa was saying is, I think we're seeing more of each other. And there's a frustration level. And as the frustration rises, it seems like we put on these glasses that focus on things that we don't have, things that we wish the other person would do or could have done better. And in that environment of criticism and complaining, happiness really just gets sucked right out of the family. The grades are coming in for the kids, and so being critical of them not getting a certain grade, or being critical of them rolling their eyes, or being critical of their complaining. And so, like I said, you know, maybe that doesn't happen in your home, but I think it's very evident that the level of happiness decreases when there's criticism and complaining that's going on in our lives. In fact, the Bible talks about this in Proverbs 21, verse 9. You want to read that?
Sure. In the Message Bible, I love that it says, better to live alone in a tumble-down shack than share a mansion with a nagging spouse. And so right there it's saying it's better to live alone in a tumble-down shack. Maybe you don't even have everything put together in there, and you might get wet, you might get cold, but it's better to live there than with a nagging spouse. Or in the New Living Translation, it says, better to live in the attic than with a nagging spouse. I mean, that's like out of the way. That's not even visible to the spouse or the children in your family. That's in the attic, far in the top of your house. And so it says it's better to live there than with a nagging spouse. And so what are we doing to switch that atmosphere in our home to become from nagging to something that's more enjoyable to live with, something that's happy to live with, rather than being complaining and criticizing of each other or of our children?
Yeah, so now if you said amen, like if an amen rose up within you when Pippa read better to live in the attic than with a nagging spouse, I'm so glad that you're listening, because if you are looking for space in the attic because you're so unhappy, that can all turn around. So it's things like we tell our kids, the same things our parents told us. What were you thinking? I mean, obviously they weren't thinking, otherwise they wouldn't have done that. Or if I've told you once, I've told you 1,000 times. You were really not. But those words of criticism and the complaining about, well, I wish we had this. Well, I wish we had a friend. I wish we could get back to work. Whatever the case may be, we see that that's sucking the very happiness in life out of a marriage and a family. All right, so let's shift gears. What do we need to put in this side of the scale to counterbalance the unhappiness? Now, there's two things. You can stop doing what you have been doing, but then there's things you can be proactive and put inside your family so that we can see more happiness. So, Pippa, what do you think we can do to bring the happiness side down or up into our families and in our homes?
I think we need to just begin to, besides having a personal and strong relationship with the Lord, because your ultimate happiness comes from your relationship with the Lord. And so we're not talking about so much as that, but that is very important. Don't miss that key on that relationship with the Lord, because no matter what is going on in your life and situation, your relationship in the Lord can determine your happiness as well. But in our family, what we're talking about, something very big is just being thankful, having a heart of gratitude and being thankful for what happens in the place. No matter what is going on, you can always find something in your home, in your children, in your spouse that you can be extremely thankful for. And in Psalms 100, verse 4, it says, enter with the password of thanksgiving. Make yourselves at home talking praise. You know, say thank you for things that are happening. And, we teach our kids the common courtesy and the habits and being thankful for things that happen in your house. But make that a priority in your spouses and in your children as well, being able to demonstrate that. And when you start having thankful, that's the opposite of being criticism. That's the opposite of complaining, because you can't complain and be thankful at the same time. So if we choose to be thankful for what's going on, or choose something in our lives and in your home and in your children that you can be thankful for, that's going to turn that criticism, that's going to turn that complaining around into thanksgiving. And you'll begin to see a shift in your heart as you give those words of thankfulness.
That's so good. And that Psalm 100, verse 4, is literally talking about the presence of God, that we enter his gates with thanksgiving, enter his courts with praise. And the message drive says, enter with the password, thank you. And so the same things that gets the presence of God in our lives are the same things that gets the presence of God in our homes. And in that presence, there's happiness. So just the art of being thankful, just saying thank you for that wonderful, incredible meal that you picked up at Costco and put in the oven. I'm just so thankful for that. It was tasted so, so good.
And if we can say thank you for working in the yard and doing what you do to make the house look good, that's also something that you can be thankful for.
For being such a handyman. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Notice I did not say that. Thank you. I just said working in the yard.
Thank you, kids, for being so diligent. You guys have been getting along. You haven't been fighting. Thank God for that, and thank you. What happens is it's beginning to tilt the scale. Well, not yet. It's not till we need to be more thankful. Oh, my word. Okay, rapid happiness. Oh, my word. Yes. See, that's the Hidden family right there. I mean, off the charts. So anyway, so being thankful. I think what happens is when we see, if we can take the glasses off of complaining, criticism, and put thanksgiving glasses on, those glasses help us focus on the good things. And when you focus on the good things, there's always bad, there's always good. But thanksgiving causes you to focus on the things that are good. And you begin to count the right things. I like what Philippians 4:8 talks about. It says, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. Find the good things and speak them out and communicate. Look for the good. They're there in every marriage, in every family. There are good things. And even if it's something small, just begin to thank them. Thank your kids for coming to the dinner table. Thank them for getting along. Thank them for not killing each other, you know, over the last 8 weeks. There's always something to be thankful for, and that thanksgiving helps us count. I like the Amplified Bible. Pippa, can you read that, the Amplified version in that verse?
It says, if there is anything worthy of praise, think on and weigh and take account of these things. Fix your mind on them. Are we thinking about them? Are we taking account for what is happening and then fixing our minds on them so that that shifts our mentality thinking when it comes to things in our home and being thankful for them?
I mean, this can turn a marriage around in 2 seconds when instead of you counting how many times he doesn't take the garbage out, you need to start counting how many times he does take the garbage out. Not saying that's only a man's job, but the same thing is instead of counting how many times she doesn't prepare the meal, start counting how many times she does and how many times she puts up with you and how many times she puts up with your socks laying on the bathroom floor. Don't count the bad things. Count the good things, and you'll begin to see some things turning around. So what we encourage you to do, even today, is not just think about the things you're thankful for your mom. I want you to write down some things to be thankful for and what you are thankful for in your spouse, in your children, and write them actually down and maybe take some time today to communicate those things to. If you have some family times, we've enjoyed our family times. We've gathered the kids around, and we've went through a 40-day prayer journey together. There have been great discussions. There have been some intense discussions. There's been some healing that's taking place. But at the end of the day, it's a time where we're not just wasting this COVID-19. Maybe just gather the kids around. If there's no kids at home, just sit with your spouse and begin to communicate. By the time you communicate those 5 things to each other, the scales will begin to tilt, and then begin to practice that. Be thankful. Count the good things. All right, what else can we do?
I think another thing that we can do is praise one another. Praise is also turning criticism around and the opposite of criticism. And it produces happiness when you're praising. And this is not in an unhealthy way. This is a healthy form of praise. In Proverbs 3:27, it says, do not withhold good from those to whom it is due when it is in your power to do it. So as parents, as spouses, as children, you have the opportunity to be able to praise one another and don't withhold that. And so, you know, saying it's a great job, that's something that you can be doing. Hey, I'm proud of you. You've done a really good job in what you've done today. I'm proud of you for finishing that work. You know, you've done good. Thank goodness that you are able to manage what you're going through right now. And so giving those opportunities of praise is something good. I know in our house, Josiah's had online schooling. He sets his alarm and he gets up every day. And I've said to him on multiple occasions, great job for getting up, getting on your computer, doing your online school. Those little things can begin to turn the criticism around and that complaining around when you offer those moments of praise in your home and what you're seeing within your children and within your spouse.
It's so true. And you can praise like, well, I don't know of anything to be that's praiseworthy. Just pray and ask God, how can I give some praise to my spouse? How can I give some praise to my kids? I mean, we've got some adult children. I mean, Mariah's 22 and Jessica's 19. And I remember, I love Jesus with all my heart like they do. It's tough being at home at that age. They're used to being on their own and being in college, and Mariah has her apartment. And so they've been incredible. So I just said, you know what? I'm going to begin to praise them for that. I know it's difficult. I know it's tough. We understand that. But right now, your safety is the utmost concern. And so we want you to stay home. And so just trying to be creative with the praising. Look for something to praise instead of always looking for things to criticize. Ephesians 4:29 says, let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth. You know, things like, oh, I can't believe you did that. You should have done it this way. What are you doing? When are you ever going to do it right? You're never going to amount to anything. Man, I can't wait until you get out of this home. And those sort of things is corrupt communication that tilts the scale to unhappiness. But instead it says, that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the here, 1 Thessalonians 5:11, therefore encourage one another, build one another up. How do we do that? With our words, with our praise. And so when there's something, when there's not something like big going on, it might be a little bit more of a challenge. You have to be a little bit more intentional, but that's what we're encouraging you to do. Be intentional. Find something that you can praise those around you with those words. Like Pippa said, I'm proud of you. Well done. Great job. If they make a mistake, that's okay. We'll get it better next time. Those type of words definitely tilt the scale and tip the scale to the happiness side. I'm afraid what happens is and we can slip into this as well. Especially if there's high tensity in what's going on around us, or maybe we're going through some things in the ministry. Sometimes it's very hard to find a good thing. Sometimes it's very hard to not point out and criticize. So what we need to do is we need to just we need to find the good things and help repeat. So what we do is we try to correct their behavior by criticizing them, instead of looking for the good behavior and praising them. Well-famous phrase that says, what's praised is repeated, or what's rewarded is repeated. If parents, if we can just, and husbands and wives, find the things that they do good that we just take for granted. Don't just take them for granted. Praise what they're doing, and they'll do more of the good and stay away from the criticism. Like Pippa said, that doesn't mean you don't correct them. You know, if they're smoking dope, you know, in the bedroom, you know, you definitely criticize that, you know, and correct that behavior. So we're not talking about not disciplining your children, but just creating this atmosphere of happiness. All right? Is that good? So Thanksgiving, praise, these are the things we're doing with our mom, but we're going to be doing these throughout. Okay, so just kind of throw this thing in at the last is this idea that I really had to work on in my own life, because I really didn't do it much in my own life. When we got married, it just doesn't come natural for me to do this. So I've intentionally tried to become more of a person that will celebrate, like have fun, spend some money to buy something, do something crazy, do something random. So Pippa, just talk about how celebrating can help tilt and tip the scale to happiness.
I think it just is, you know, when you celebrate something, you're enjoying what's taking place. You're letting what took place in that situation, that you're proud of them, your kids, that you're proud of them, that your spouse, that you're proud of them. And so find things that you can celebrate. And I'm not talking about celebrating in huge, expensive ways. I'm just talking about little things that can say, hey, let's celebrate about that today. And I know, you know, we've tried to do this within our home in different situations. And so the kids may get all good grades. And so we'll celebrate that. Or a new practice of a new team. You know, I know that Josiah's done this before, and we'll pick him up from something, or I'll pick him up from school, and it'll be the first of something, and I'll be like, hey, let's go to Starbucks, or let's go to McDonald's and get your drink that you like, so that we can celebrate what's taken place that day. We try and find little things that we don't go out all the time. We're not big going out to eat people. We don't spend a lot of money on things like that. So our kids know that doing something small like that is some form of celebration that they can take and say, hey, let's go do that. And we'll find ways that we can do that within our home and our family. Just a couple weeks ago, I think when the shelter in place started lifting up a little bit, our kids love snowballs and Woodstock. And, you know, so we all went there and we took them out. We're like, let's get out of the house. Let's go celebrate. We've been locked in for 8 weeks or 9 weeks or 10 weeks or whatever it is for you. But we go and we take them out. We go and get one of those. Now, we still use some social distancing and cleaning on all of that. But we go and we celebrate. We try and find things that we can do that just show our kids, hey, we're proud of you. We love you. Let's go do this together. And you can also do that with your spouse. And finding ways to be able to celebrate each other, finding ways to celebrate in the home. Do something different that you don't normally do so that it shows an aspect of honor. It shows an aspect of, hey, I'm proud of you. It shows an aspect of you mean well and you mean something and you're worth it. And so we want to be able to show that in our family and in our home.
Yeah, I think that's great. And we've worked on this, and just even the little things. I mean, just the other day, I'm like, okay, what can we celebrate? I feel like going out. Let's do something. Well, what can we celebrate? And I can't remember. We just come up with some random things. Well, it's like the 39th day of the pandemic. That's a reason to celebrate. You were talking about Josiah. Josiah got in the car maybe two years ago, picked him up from practice. Pippa was already making the meal. We're driving home, and as soon as he gets in the car, he goes, can we go to Starbucks? I'm like, well, no, we want to get home. And the kids, they catch on. They're like, Dad, we need to celebrate. I'm like, what are you talking about? Well, there's nothing to celebrate. This was my first practice with this new team. I mean, so they're learning to come up with. I said, yes, I didn't want to do it. I want to just get home and eat. And I said, let's do it. Let's celebrate. You're on this new team. It's going to be a great season. I'm just telling you, when you celebrate others and celebrate, and when it comes to the grades, we started this years ago. I don't know whose bright idea this was because it's a very costly idea. We decided to reward our children. If they get an A on their report card, we give them $10, okay? And if they get a B, they get $5. If they get a C, they give me $10. And so it's kind of a reverse deal. I'm kind of praying for them to get bad grades. But anyway, they get good grades. And so they might get 6 A's and 2 B's or something like that. So we celebrate those things. Parents, I want you to be careful. Because you can use the grades to either tilt at the happiness or unhappiness. Too many parents go it the wrong way. I can't believe you got a B. Why didn't you get a B? What do you mean you got an 89 if you just would have done a little bit better? And they're criticizing the B instead of being thankful they didn't get a C. Come on, somebody. And instead of being, I can't believe you got a B or I can't believe you got a C, just be thankful they didn't get a D. Thank God that they passed the class. Okay, find something. And if you begin to shift it into praise and shift it into thanksgiving, you'll see life come. And it's a very expensive journey for us. I mean, we just found out, I mean, Mariah's got like, she's got all these classes in college and practicums, and she's making out like a chieftain this time around. And Jessica and Josiah, we had to take out a loan, just pay these kids, you know, but it's worth the celebration. It really is. And we don't just say, well, okay, we don't just like put a direct deposit in. We're going to take them out. Two, 3 weeks ago, we were just feeling the pressures of the pandemic and not going out. And one of the favorite places is a steakhouse that we like to go to. And was it your birthday? It was your birthday. I know, but.
Of course. We did that seminar.
We did the seminar. I just remembered. I encouraged the whole family to do an online seminar, which was like all day Friday night and all day Saturday. I encouraged them. I pastored them through the process of decision-making to accept my encouragement to go through an online seminar, and they did. for the most part, they did a really good job. And I thought, okay, guys, let's celebrate. And so we decide, we called, what's the place called? Texas Roadhouse. And we normally go and we get, you know, like the 10-ounce, 11-ounce steak. I said, we're going to celebrate. Let's get the any steak you want. So they got the big old, like, 20-ounce steak. And we just had a great time celebrating. And I'm just telling you, whenever you do that, it causes happiness. The Bible says, rejoice always. Celebrate always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus. So rejoicing. So Pippa, just kind of recap, and then we can close in some prayer. What did we learn today?
We're just looking to learn to create environments of being thankful, having a gratitude, a grateful heart, being thankful for things that are going on in our lives. And this is counting the good things and overlooking the bad. But again, like I said, it's not overlooking behavior, things that need to be corrected. You do need to do that as parents and as husbands and wives in the home. You need to be able to bring that correction. I'm just talking about the little things that happen, the little mistakes every now and then. Overlook those. Be thankful that you have kids. Some people aren't in a process where they can be thankful for the kids in their home. So be thankful for what they're doing. Be thankful that you have the kids in your home, and look for ways that you can show that and express that to them and to your spouse. Praise one another. You know, let them know that you're proud of them. Use words of encouragement to lift them up and bring up their countenance about them and praise them. And then again, just celebrate. Have some fun. Get crazy ideas that you can do. Things that your kids will look back on. Things that your spouse will look back on and go, hey, I remember those moments. I remember those times of being crazy and having fun together and celebrating. And not only does this create just a happy environment in your home, but you'll help lift each other up and encourage each other. And everybody will feel better about themselves in your home when you have those moments of thankfulness and gratitude and praising one another rather than criticizing them.
Yeah, I just want to give a shout out to my own mom. Hopefully she's watching. They did a good job. We played games as a family. We took vacations, and I've got some very good memories that I reach back on in my own life. So, Mom, happy Mother's Day. You did a great job. Love you very much. So let's go ahead and let's pray. You want to close and pray. You pray for moms and pray whatever's on your heart, and then I'll close and pray blessings. And then remember, right after this, the children's ministry. Julie's been doing such a good job. They've got a special tribute to moms, and so we want you to watch right after the service, the children's ministry segments. Let's just go to God and let's just pray over all those that are watching.
God, I thank you for this opportunity that we can hear your word and to have you in our lives. God, we're so thankful, first and foremost, that you're our Father, that no matter what we do, you continue to love us, you continue to honor us, you continue to praise us, you encourage us as your children, God, and we're so thankful for that. You're the best parent any of us could ever have. But God, on this day, I pray for every mom that's out there. I pray your hand of blessing on their lives. Lord, you know what it is that they're going through. This is a different kind of situation. None of us have ever been here where we're in moments of quarantine and moments of being away. Maybe there's some people here that aren't able to see their moms today because they're in a home and they can't get to them. God, I pray that you fill them with your peace, that you fill them with your love, that you just pour your blessings on their life today. God, every mom, wherever they may be at today, that you pour your blessing on their lives. God, I thank you that they're all your daughters. You delight in them. You cherish them. God, you're the lifter of their head. So today, God, I thank you that you lift their head, that you shine your blessing on them, that they will feel so enveloped by your love, your encouragement, and your grace. God, I thank you for blessing them. I thank you for when they're weary and they're tired, that you're their strength. God, I thank you that when something's just get out of control in their lives, God, that you bring that peace within their heart and in their soul, that they can look to you and receive from you today. God, we thank you that you're faithful to meet that. You're faithful to pick them up. You're faithful to carry them. God, there's a lot of moms that have gone through different circumstances over the last 8 weeks and being home and maybe not being able to go to work, having to homeschool their children and in situations where they never thought they would find themselves. God, I thank you that you sustain them. I thank you that you continue to refresh their minds, refresh their strength, God, as Some of them have had their children every day where normally they're at school, normally they're at daycare. And Lord, I thank you for refreshing them. I thank you for pouring a blessing on their lives. I thank you for enriching them, that those times with their children have been enriched, that there have been many memorable bonding moments, God, within their hearts and their souls. God, I thank you that it's a day that we can honor all the moms today. And Lord, you honor every mom today as your special daughter, a blessing, a treasure that you have. God, I thank you that no matter what it is that they're going through, that they would know of your love. They would know of your proud moments on their lives, that you would shine that on them, God. We thank you now for your hand being on them. I thank you for leading them. I thank you for guiding them. I thank you for blessing and enriching them, God, that whatever care they may have on their shoulders today, that they will place it in your hands, that you will lift them up, that you will take that care from them. And I thank you, God, that today is going to be a blessed day for them. Today is going to be a joyous day as they celebrate who they are and what you've called them to be, the ultimate gift of being a mom and raising children. God, we thank you for that. We thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your increase in our lives. It's in your name we pray.
Amen. Amen. We do declare God's blessings over you. We're praying that happiness will rise and unhappiness will flee out of your lives. Thank you so much for being a part of our service. Pip and I, we continue to pray for you all throughout the week. Join us Thursday night at 7. Circle the church in prayer. Make sure that come today. That's right. Come today at 1 o'clock. Put your mom in the car, grandmother in the car. We even take future moms in the car and just drive by, circle around the back of the building. And there'll be a parking lot team here to help you, direct you. And we're going to hand you a rose. We're going to pray for you. So just a final blessing. Father, I just thank you. I declare your blessings upon every person that's watching here. I declare your blessings over Victory Church. Father, I thank you that everywhere they turn, they find divine favor, wisdom, and increase. I thank you that whatever they put their hand to prospers. I thank you that they have the peace of God, the joy of the Holy Spirit. I thank you, Father God, that you give them perseverance during the sheltered in. I thank you that you are their provision, God. I thank you that you're opening up doors. I thank you for breakthroughs happening, God. I just thank you that you are rising up within them a courage and a faith to be able to distinguish themselves amongst others, that they can be looked upon. And people say, they are with God. So, Father, I declare it over them now in Jesus' name. Until we come back together, Father, we thank you for them. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much.
Good morning, everyone. How are you doing? It's Miss Julie here, and I'm at the Victory Kids check-in, and I wanted to welcome you this morning. Do you know what special day this is today? That's right, it's Mother's Day. So moms, if you're watching, happy Mother's Day. We love you so much, and we care about you. Thank you for all that you do in our lives. I have a very special lesson planned for the kids and for the mothers today. So let's head into the V-Zone and get started. Here we are in the V-Zone hallway. I have a great game that I want to teach you guys. It's called Jump Freeze. And the way that you play this is when the music turns on, you start jumping from circle to circle. If the music stops, then you stop. Today I'm going to try and make it all the way down the hallway to the red circle. Do you think that I can do it? All right, I'm going to try. Let's go. Yay! I finally made it, guys! Are you so proud of me? Okay, I'll meet you in the room for worship. The song for worship today is called Big Big House by Audio Adrenaline. It's a super fun song that we like to sing here in the V-Zone. So wherever you are, go ahead and stand up and get ready to join me. If you don't know the words, they're going to be on the screen. And you can follow along with the motions with me, okay? Let's get started. Thank you. I hope you enjoyed that song. Well, today I have a lesson and it's all about honoring our moms. What does it mean to honor our mother? To honor means that you're going to give someone high respect, high regard for their great achievement. And why is that so important? Well, the Bible talks about how we need to honor our mother and our father. And I'm going to read you some verses that explains why that's so important. The first one is in Exodus 20, verse 12. It says, "Honor your father and your mother so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you." Another verse is in Colossians 3:20. It says, "Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord." And did you know that it's actually the fifth commandment to honor your parents? And there's actually a promise attached to it. It says that God will give you long life if you do. One more verse that we have is found in Ephesians. It says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right." Now listen, if it's important to God, it should be important to us. And as Christians, we want to obey God in all that we do. So when we obey our mother and honor her, we're actually obeying God. And now listen, Jesus understands that sometimes it's difficult for us to honor our mom all the time. Now listen, he was a kid and he had a mother too. His mother's name was Mary. And he was a great son and he obeyed his mom in all that he did and said. But sometimes it's really, really hard. So we can ask God for help so that we can also honor our mom. Now listen, there are different ways that we can bring her honor, and I have some examples for you. The first one is with our time. So we can spend our time with our mom doing fun things with her, things that she likes to do. We can watch movies, we can go for a walk. There are lots of things that we can do to have fun with our mom. The next thing is by giving her hugs and kisses. Does your mom like when you give her a hug and a kiss? I know I love when my kids give me hugs and kisses. So that's one way that you can show her that you love her and honor her. Another way is by, can you see that? Helping with chores around the house. Cleaning the dishes, helping with laundry, maybe cleaning your room or the bathrooms. That will show your mom that you care about her and you love her when you help her out. Another way that you can show her that you are honoring her is by telling her how great she is in a sweet little love note or a card. I'm sure lots of moms out there love to receive cards, don't you? So go ahead and write down your thoughts about your mom and share them with her. I'm sure she'll love that. And the last way I have is that you can give her a gift. Now, you don't have to spend a lot of money to show your mom that you care and you love her, but you can honor her with simple things and that will really make her day and make her feel special. I have a fun activity for you that is going to help you review ways that we could show honor or dishonor to mom. So I'm going to read the card for you and you tell me which side I should put it on. Okay, are you ready? All right, the first one is, give your mom a hug when she feels bad. Which one do you think it is, honor or dishonor? That's right, that's honor. Okay. The next one is help your mom set the table for dinner. What do you think? That's right, that's honor too. All right, let's read the next one. It says, give your mom a bad attitude when she tells you it's time to go to bed. Which one would that be, honor or dishonor? That's right, that's dishonor. The next one is continue to play your video games when your mom tells you to clean your room. Which one would that be, honor or dishonor? That's right, that's dishonor. Okay. And then the next one is lie to your mom when you get in trouble. Would that be bringing honor or dishonor to mom? That's right, that's dishonor. And the last one, I think you know where it should go, but let's go ahead and read it anyways. Tell your mom she looks beautiful and you love her. That's right, that's honoring to mom. Did you get them all right? Good. Good job, guys.